Have you ever looked out the window when you should have been working or studying? What if your whole job was just to study the sky? Hey plasmids, Trace here for DNews. Radar as we know it was invented in the mid-1930s to detect airplanes before they could drop their bombs. Basically, radar shoots radio waves out into the world, and if those waves bounce off something and make it back to the dish, engineers, or now computers, could triangulate the position and size of the thing. By the late 1970s, radar had gotten so sensitive that with the right equipment, scientists could try to bounce waves off all sorts of things, even the smallest of things, electrons and ions in the upper atmosphere. This is great because scientists wanted to know what exactly those beautiful auroras we could see at night were made of, and what the sun was doing to our planet all day, every day. So the European Incoherent Scatter Scientific Association built the EISCAT Svalbard radar in 1996. Its goal is to study the interaction between the sun and Earth's atmosphere using radar.
Yes, I mean, this is a very potent radar system, I should say. We have at this site two big parabolic dishes. One dish is 42 meters in diameter, and the second antenna is 32 meters in diameter. The power amplifier that we are using have a peak power of 1 megawatt. And we need this because what we are studying is these free electrons at 100 kilometers. Firstly, I mean, they are far away, and these are just free electrons, so they are very, very tiny.
These massive dishes sit on a Svalbardian mountaintop just to measure the plasma surging through our upper atmosphere. Plasma is ionized or electrically charged gas.
The ions we mostly looked is oxygen, nitrogen, and so on. And looking at how many free electrons do we have, and also what kind of ion species we actually have up in the ionosphere.
The plasma originates from the sun's corona and is pulled down onto the poles of the Earth by our planetary magnetic field. At that point, the ions and electrons interact with molecules in our atmosphere, exciting them and causing the beautiful lights that we call auroras.
The principle is almost like an old television screen, where you have the phosphorus and you have the electron beam that's impinging on the phosphorus and it starts to glow.
In fact, they use old television components to suck in all this information. As it stands now, their components are literally off-the-shelf 100-kilowatt analog television transmitters linked together. They attach those to a giant movable antenna dish, and voila, aurora-sensitive radar.
Mostly of the power that we are transmitting is just going out to outer space. But we have still some power that are reflected back, and this power we can then detect with our big antennas. We are able to detect very, very small objects. In principle, just on one single shot, we are able to detect like a ball bearing at 200 kilometers. So the system is very, very sensitive.
Because they can detect these ball bearings, the EISCAT dishes could be used to detect space junk too, but mostly they're looking for space weather.
Mostly what we can learn is how the solar wind are interacting with the near atmosphere. I mean, a solar cycle is 11 years between the peaks on the sunspots. So we have good data that scientists can use for this kind of looking into models and so on.
Basically, EISCAT is just like your local weather radar, but for space. Scientists all over the world pay to access this radar data and draw conclusions for their own studies. See, EISCAT isn't studying the data themselves per se, they're just taking measurements.
We are pushing the technology, and of course this is one good thing, but again, this is basic research, so it's... When you do the research today, it's very difficult to actually say what will be the outcome.
This is basic science on a planetary scale. Basic research is also called pure research because they're not working under a hypothesis, they're just gathering information. EISCAT's datasets are massive and comprehensive, just like early weather data monitoring. More data, more better. So EISCAT ran for a whole year to provide a baseline for what the sun does to our planet's atmosphere every day, because before that, we had no idea.
Today they are talking about going to Mars. And when you're going to Mars, then you need to know the space weather and where these plasma blobs will hit and so on. If not, then you're in big danger, I should say. And this is one of these things that actually you can use this facility for, or the data set we have accumulated for 35 years, to be able to make this kind of space weather predictions.
Basic research like this helps us understand the world around us, or in this case, the world above us.
You have always to show that you have our customers, the scientists around. And if you can show that and show that they are doing sensible research that have some value, then hopefully you get the money to actually do it.
We've been talking about our trip to Svalbard for months, but if you missed it, we went to visit the Svalbard Global Seed Vault, also called the Doomsday Vault. It was so amazing. Check out how we're going to secure the future of our food here.
Inside that vault are boxes, and inside those boxes...
seeds. Quite simply, seeds. So normally somewhere between 300 and 500 seeds in these aluminum foil envelopes. And that's all there is. Nothing else.
Have you ever seen an aurora? I saw one once. If you have, tell us about it down in the comments below, and make sure you subscribe so that you get more D News.